Welcome to the Sunderland School Committee meeting for Tuesday, March 21st, 2017. We have a pretty focused agenda tonight around the FY18 budget. And in fact, we will start with a public hearing on that. So I will turn it over to our business manager, Patty Kavanaugh, to kind of run through the highlights another time, another round of the highlights, a little bit of update.
Sure.
And then we can.
So last night we met with the town select board and the town finance committee, we presented a budget to them that was about $186,000, a 7.81% increase. And today I was reviewing that budget, and since the time that we started developing it and now, we've had some staff changes. We've had some people leave, and then we've hired new people. So I was reviewing to see if we had any savings there, and in that review, I did find that there was an error. Somebody's salary was in two budgets, both the school choice and the town appropriation. So I corrected that, and in doing that, we were able to bring down this budget by $30,095. And you can see that on page 7 of 28. At this point, once we present to the town, I usually like to keep track of the versions so that everybody can, it's very transparent as to what's changing and when. But for our...
So it's a note, this is like for really...
It says version 3.
Oh yeah, public hearing, perfect, great.
And all the pages are marked as such. Mm-hmm.
Awesome.
So starting on page 6 of 28, this is a new page of our budget that Dr. Carey brought with her. And we call it our student and staff data sheet. And on the left is our student information, and on the right is our staff. So upper left is our population census as of October 1st of this past year. And we lock that in because that's what our foundation enrollment is based on. So we had 257 children. And so using that as a base, we're projecting our 2018 enrollment. And the down below, we do change monthly as our population here changes in the school. So this projection is based on our March 1st enrollment report. And right now we're expecting 35 kindergartners, which would bring our school population to 260, which is a plus 3. Now, at this point, it's a plus 3. Historically, we've gotten a lot of traffic in over the summer with new people moving into the district. So it may be even higher than that, but we won't know until that happens. On the right, what we've done is we're keeping track of how many people are employed here at Sunderland Elementary. And last year, we had 53.7 staff, and for 18, we're asking for 57.9, and it's an addition of 4.2. It would be one classroom teacher, which is our early childhood. We are adding a second early childhood class. And that early childhood is actually now also going full day program, 5 days a week. 0.05 art teacher, that was something that was determined after our budget last year. We shared this art teacher with Deerfield. They needed her for one section less, and we needed her for one section more because of our population growth, so that's why that went up. Instructional assistants, we've added two, and those are strictly based on IEP needs. Our speech and language went up 0.6, physical therapy 0.05, and our occupational therapy 0.1. And those are all in direct correlations to our student population and their needs. And custodians, we're asking to take, right now we have 1.6 custodians, and we're asking to bring that to 2 full-time custodians. With the population in the building, the number of students we have, according to metrics, we should have 2 full-time custodians. So we're making that request to make it 2 full-time positions. And then down below, these are the columns that our teaching, credentialed teaching staff have in their contract. And we've listed how many people are in each category. The Masters Plus 45 CAGS is new to the contract, and we had 2 staff that did qualify for that. So going to our summary of changes, the collective bargaining agreement, the steps added $23,317. The negotiated increase for this year is 2.5%. That added $39,935. Degree changes, $5,135. The lead teacher stipend was increased in the last negotiation, so that increased $1,100. We're moving our funding source for our music and Spanish from school choice funds to the town appropriation in the amount of $23,700. We had the increase for an instructional assistant of $23,789. And the amount to add the full-time custodian would be $7,956. We're having an allowance of $39.50 for our non-union salaries. We will present those to you in May, and you will vote on those in June. And then, as I talked about, the adjustments for the salary and the doubling up of an IA is reducing the budget by $30,095. Our other operational increases, Sunderland is taking a large hit in the central office percentage. You're going up from 16.13 to 18.43. And that's basically based on our enrollment. So because Sunderland is the only school that's growing, and the three other elementaries, they're not even maintaining, they're losing. So it's gotta go somewhere. So it's unfortunately going to Sunderland. But we did have some increases in the costs at the central office, particularly around two staff members who were funded with grants. So our elementary curriculum director was funded partially by Title I, and that has been decreasing every year, both in the Commonwealth and for each city and town. And the second was the elimination of the kindergarten grant by Governor Baker in his budget, and that was in large part funding our early childhood director. The other big hit to the central office budget was the increase in health insurance for people in the central office. The blended rate between the two types of policies went up 10.4% for health insurance and 8% on our dental. And the Frontier, the employer pays 80% of that. We did have some decreases also in the central office budget by shuttering 219 Christian Lane and moving to Frontier. And those estimates of decrease were very conservative, and we should see more next year. But not knowing the actual cost of running an empty building, we were conservative in what we cut from that budget as far as utilities. The school committee expenses, this is $1,315. This is our collaborative dues. This is not new. We've been members of the collaborative. This has just never been budgeted, and we've been using another grant to pay it, and it's really not appropriate to use that grant for this money, so we added it. Mr. Barszewski's asking for a $2,000 increase in our general supplies, so to meet our population needs. Sped support services, an increase of $3,000, and this is just so that we have more children receiving vision services and assistive technology, I think Karen, our Sped director, told me was the other thing. The software is $14,764. This was done by our IT director. His first year here, he focused on hardware, inventorying all the buildings, and his second year, we identified all softwares that everyone is using across the district. And there was a lot more than we knew was that was happening. So we looked at each type of software, we reclassified it to where the appropriate DESI reporting is, and we also changed the allocation methods on depending on what type of software it is. Sometimes we're dividing it across the schools by the number of teachers. Some were using staff, some were using devices. So that was something after IT identified the cost, then he and I then sat down and decided the allocation method based on the type of software it was.
Does that include classroom as well as administrative?
It doesn't include what we call the district-wide data. So in that category is like our student information, our SPED, our SNAP for the nurses. This is truly
in the building.
In the building, either to run the softwares that are running our networks.
Right.
The classroom softwares for curriculum.
Right.
It's also Microsoft like Office licenses, mm-hmm. all that type of stuff. Okay. So it's all types all over the place.
Okay.
Transportation, we needed to add $2,059 for SPED monitors. Some of our children require assistance on supervision on the bus. and increase in professional development stipends. There is a $600 allowance per teacher per year and $50 per IA, and this 1650 brings us in line with the number of staff that we have. We did make two reductions, one in the building heat. We decreased $10,000. And last year we had a teacher that retired and we had $16,758. And we have none that have so far announced that they're leaving us. So we were able to decrease $16,758, a net increase of $155,568 or 6.55%. So the total amount that we will be requesting from the town is $2,531,758. And I apologize, that little $155,568, that's my little check digit that I usually delete once I'm in balance, and I didn't do it. So I apologize for that number there.
Does the $23,789 for the instructional assistance, is that for the two instructional assistants?
One. So one we were funding from the town appropriation, and one we were funding from another source. I'm not really sure if I believe we did it under the sped revolving. We added an IA in the sped revolving. And sometimes when we add those types of IAs, if they're coming for a child who we're tuitioning into our program, the sending town pays for that IA. So what the money we receive goes in the sped revolving, and that's where we pay their payroll from.
But that's not necessarily the case for this one, right?
No, there was one that needed to get added to our budget and one to the two. One was our budget and one was the Horizons budget.
Okay. So would we consider this additional instructional assistant, is that going to Horizons or is that going to?
This is the one that's in our classroom. In a it's a one-on-one assistance to a child in general education inclusion classes. Okay, so the next pages is all the detail by our line items.
Okay, quick question.
Sure.
The cut to the support for the kindergarten grant in the governor's budget. So, do we have any sense of whether the legislature is going to?
Probably not, because the way they're looking at it is that this grant was initiated in order for all schools to get to full-time kindergarten, and everybody's basically there, and everybody gets those kids counted in their foundation enrollment, so they look at this as a redundant grant.
Okay. So.
Unfortunately.
Yep.
So pages 8 through 16 are the detail of the town appropriation budget. And then starting on page 17, we have all our funding expenditures. So if we just flip to the end of that, which is page 25, we'll look at our total. So our town appropriation of $2,531,758 will represent about 79% of our budget. 13% will be school choice at $425,493. Our early childhood revolving will supply $20,000 in funding. Our SPED revolving will do $158,48. Title I, $15,806. And the IDA grant, $63,616. For a total budget for Sunderland Elementary for fiscal year 18 of $3,207,521. The next page is a little detail of what's been happening with our school choice funds. And we used to spend this a year in arrear, but we no longer do that because our needs, even though our NESDEC study kept saying we were only gonna need one kindergarten, that only happened 1 year. And 3 years since, we keep adding another section of kindergarten, and we've been putting those teachers on this budget. So this year, we're expected to bring in $349,087, but if you look at the negative amount above it, that means we already spent $261,955, so we really only have $87,000.
That $261,955 is last year.
Yes, it's what we're going to end with.
We've spent in this current year, right?
Right. But what I'm showing you below so that everyone understands, even though I'm showing negative numbers, it's not cash-wise. Cash-wise is what I've shown you down below, how we spend it. So in the bank, even though I'm showing at the end of 18, we'll be 338 in the hole, what we'll have sitting in our coffers is $34,919.
Where's that number?
On the bottom of page 26, towards the left. This is more like the cash flow of how this fund works.
Right. Okay.
And that is a pretty low, we usually use these funds that are left in school choice as our contingency for move-in situations, and this is the lowest it's ever been. And we are now, as you can see, no longer spending a year in arrears, we're spending a year that we earn it. So the money we get in 18 is the money we're spending in 18. Before, we used to get the money in 18 and not spend it till 19. And we're not doing that anymore.
What allowed that to happen, Patty?
The overutilization and reliance of school choice.
What allowed that balance to build up?
The fact that we
started at zero.
Okay, so when the school choice money first started coming in to the schools, when Sunderland first accepted school choice, the money was used to supplement the budget. So it brought back things that had been reduced when the override failed. So we used it to bring back music. We used it to bring back our language program. And then as our SPED population started to grow, we started using it to take care of some of our SPED costs. And we were using that so that the request to the towns wouldn't be as large every year. And now we over-rely on it. Because now we
can see it. We brought in 373, and we spent 443.
Right.
So, and we were able to do that because we had that surplus from the, some sense.
Correct.
Yeah.
So then on page 27, I've given you the same for how our SPED revolving works, and this is our Horizons program. That we instituted about 4 years ago here at Sunderland. So this is open, this program is open to not just Sunderland students, but we tuition in students from our sister schools of the Union. And if we have available spots after that, we go out any other city or town that's near us. We also accept children and they pay tuition. And so do our sister schools pay tuition for us to take their kids into this specialized program. And that's all I have.
So. Kind of gone through the in my head back of the envelope kind of math on the choice before, but the revenue on the choice, the like what 373 or the projected, yeah, the 373 would be based on,
where's the 373?
FY17
revenue, yes, the 373.
So that's from this school year's choice?
Correct. That's
right?
What we're projected to bring
in by the time this is done.
Correct. And so then the reason it's going to go down in 18 is because what I did was I looked at the roster and what they're projecting 373. I'm not, because I know we have a couple of school choice sixth graders and some of them have a SPED increment. I'm taking that out because they're not going to be here.
Right.
So we're not going to get that money.
Right. You can't, certainly can't rely. Maybe that would be a situation where we can't rely on that.
Right.
And if we did, we might have additional expenses.
Exactly.
So I was just like, you know, we've got 46 boys and girls school choice, and isn't it like $5,500 or
$5,000 per student?
Per student. So that's like, you know, well short of 373.
The rest would be in SPED increments.
Oh, so that all comes in. Right.
Correct. So if we that's 200. So 46 times 5,000 is $230,000.
Right.
So if any student that we take in on school choice ends up having special education needs, we are allowed to bill for the SPED increment. So anything, and there's funding for OT, PT, they give us the amount.
Okay.
And so we take their grid and we price out the cost and we add it
Got
to
it.
Our request for school choice.
Got it.
And the sending
like
town,
saying,
right.
The,
and the sending town has to pay us for that.
And with that, the sixth grader is going out, so that's where we're going.
Correct.
Okay. Got it. Thanks.
Well, we're looking at bringing in $349.87 next year.
Correct. That's an estimate, yes.
It's an estimate. And then
it could go up, it could go down.
we're also looking at spending 425.
Correct.
Estimate as well.
Correct.
So.
And this is why I told the town, next year,
right,
we're gonna have to take probably 100,000 or more off this budget and ask the town for it.
Of what we're spending out of school choice.
Right, because these, regardless of having school choice students, the staff on these that are paid from this fund are required in our building.
I mean, it's got to be, like you said, it's got to be at least 100,000 because, say, I mean, if we're spending 425 this year, take 100, so 325 versus a revenue of 349 and only having a cushion of 34 at the end of FY18, that's still cutting it pretty close given that those are uncertain numbers.
And what we're funding, if you look on page 5 in my narrative, 3.7 classroom teachers are funded at $182,238, 11 instructional assistants at $237,255, and we have an allowance of $6,000 for our ESOL, which are English language tutors. We do have an ELL teacher in the building, but we have to hire tutors for the native language part of that because our ELL teacher doesn't speak 10 different languages. So when we have a child that comes in from Africa or where else have we gotten students this year, Ben?
We have a couple Korean students.
So we have to find native language speakers and we hire them as tutors.
All right.
I have to exit. I put a memo with the financial report about something that I'm concerned about, but we can talk about it in April. Thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations to Kathy.
No, thank you, Doug.
I'll take these back.
Okay,
thank you.
All right. Questions? This is public hearing, so questions or comments from
on the budget?
The public on the budget, yes. Thanks
I'm just
for
putting it all in right
all now. Right. I mean, certainly we can all participate as well, but just want to give folks an opportunity.
I'm really concerned about our budget next year already.
Yep.
So the number that keeps rolling around in my head is the 141,000 that was mentioned last night, that Proposition 2.5 basically enables us to go up. And I'm encouraged that I see the numbers come down to 155,000 that we'd be requesting, but it's still above that threshold. And then next year we're gonna be looking at the same thing.
We're looking at, right, because
a significant increase.
It'd be in that ballpark because just what we'd need to come down for off of the choice alone, let alone regular contractual and step increases.
You can see how even we started this year by taking our Spanish, I think it is,
and music to move out of the choice. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
We changed the funding of music and Spanish, so we took 23,000 off already from school choice.
Yeah. I think we do bring in obviously a good chunk of school choice money, so I think, you know, we can rely on a certain amount of that for year to year, barring dramatic changes in the school that would affect our school choice numbers. But but obviously we can't keep doing it the way we've been doing it the past several years, where we've been trying to keep down the request to the town and spending into the surplus we have in choice. So
my big concern right now, and I keep going around the instructional assistant numbers, and I know, Ben, you've done a lot of work with it and shifting people around.
Sure.
But it's getting to the point where it's almost, and I've had conversations with community members, especially after last night, we're looking at nearly two instructional assistants per classroom teachers. Like, it's almost perception, it's almost like two additional people in a classroom. And I know the fine details aren't like that, but that's a difficult one for me to defend, and especially I'm not really sure of the fine details and how they move between classrooms, and I don't know how that number compares to other districts. And I look at the additional instructional assistant for next year, 23.7, you know, if that one does not come in, then that brings us under the $140,000. And then when we start looking at where can we start to pare down, that is the biggest chunk. If we go back to like page 5, between the classroom teachers, $182,000, and the instructional assistants of $237,000, that's, in preparation for next year, that's almost a necessary place to look.
Sure, and I completely hear what you're saying. Since day one, we have really tried to make a concerted effort to staff appropriately. And where there was the need, wherever that was in the building, we tried to meet that need. So yes, you know, we're requesting 26 instructional assistants for next school year, but that's based on need, strictly based on need. And it's not something that we would just want to play around with because it's convenient.
How many of those are part of the Horizons program?
Five. Okay. I'd have to just do some quick math, but I believe five.
And I think there's three in pre-K right now. Well, there's three plus the one that's leaving in June when that student moves back to another school. So I believe there's three in pre-K, and there's five in Horizons. But I think there's one in Horizons that's half a day in Horizons and then goes into a classroom. And then there's two, there's one for each special ed teacher. So when the special ed teacher is differentiating for a group of kids, there's also an IA in there.
And do we have any strictly one-on-one IAs that travel with a student, is with the student all day?
Yes, both in the Horizons program and outside.
I would look at and correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the Horizons program does bring in revenue.
It does.
So that one I can leave aside. It's trying to get through the classrooms one. I mean, can we get almost get to a situation where it's like a one IA in a classroom?
And some classrooms right now have very little IA support, and some have two or three depending on the needs. And it's really a chess match, and we're trying to figure out at what times during the day do these specific classrooms need the most support. So one thing we've also been trying to do is if an IA is not needed in one classroom, he or she will end up in another part of the building to provide support. Some quick math, in pre-K through 6, we have 10 regular ed IAs who provide individual classroom support. And then, so the other 16 would be meeting special ed needs.
Including the five Horizons?
Including the five Horizons, yep.
I mean, the tough thing, I mean, it, you know, instructional assistants are like an inexpensive, a relatively inexpensive way to take a situation, you know, what could be a problematic dynamic in a classroom and make it much, you know, a much more manageable, productive classroom. Correct me if I'm wrong. I mean, that's the tricky thing. It's almost like, if we didn't have that, would we be looking at situations where we would be looking at, like, really needing to have another classroom teacher to make, you know, it a positive experience, learning experience for kids based on the needs of the classroom? I don't know, but I know that instructional assistants make a lot less than the classroom teachers.
and I don't want to like personalize it, because from my experiences, there was one point this past school year where, because of the movement around and people helping different students and being assigned to different students, I ended up with four adults in a single classroom. Mm-hmm. And that, so I was teaching it, and then I had three instructional aides in there at one time. And I remember looking around at one point being like, I don't think this is resources well spent at this point.
Sure.
Like, I didn't need it. So that's my big fear of how much do we need? I know you've done a lot of work trying to, mm-hmm. to pair them up, but that's, to me, that's the biggest number that sticks out when we talk about.
And one of the things I want to point out is that the layout of where the instructional assistants are in the building are primarily, the higher numbers are at the younger grades. And what we found is that through early intervention and as much support as we can give these students who are coming in with high needs, by the time they reach the older grades, by the time they're reaching middle school, high school, those supports are not as needed. Additionally, one could also argue that having this extra support helps to keep some of these students in our district as well. Now, we don't know that for a fact, right? But if we were not able to meet the needs of some students, they might be looking elsewhere. Just like some students come to Sunderland looking for the same thing, for that support.
It is something that we go over constantly and that we look at over and over again.
I mean, I think that, you know, the elephant in the room is that, you know, unless there's some miracle that the select board's able to pull off in terms of the overall town budget, you know, we are, you know, with what we're bringing, you know, I think it would be really hard to avoid, you know, not going to look for an override to be able to fund the overall budget. So, and if that fails, which it has the last two times that it's come up, you know, we may be asked to cut this, and then we do have to think about, you know, okay, then none of this is good, but what's the least evil to cut?
I will state, again tonight, as we did last night, Sunderland is below the state average in what they pay in cost per student. And you know and I know that there's a strong correlation between, not that it's the be-all end-all, but between high MCAS scores or higher MCAS scores and going a little bit above the state average. We're under the state average, but our scores are pretty strong. We're doing really well with the diverse community that we have and the high needs. We're bridging that gap because we have so many individuals supporting students in this school. And I understand at one time Sunderland was a level one school, and then they lost a bunch of funding, but we are still a level two school and we're doing well. But this is what we need to think about. My problem when I was listening last night was when they said, well, last year it was 10%, and now we're asking again for 7, and so we're putting 7.8, so now it's 18% over 2 years. But one doesn't really have to do with the other, because we were forced to last year to raise our minimum amount of spending per student. We didn't have a choice. I mean, we were so below that we had to bring it up. This year, it's sort of a maintaining and right-sizing based on looking squarely in the eye of school choice. What are we doing with school choice? And trying to prepare ourselves for next year. We're taking a little bit off now. We are looking with a critical eye, and I think Principal Barshevsky can tell you I'm very critical about who we need, where is that person, what are they doing, show me, I need to see it. I've been in enough schools, I've been a principal for years, I need to see it. it's not something, oh, we need somebody, somebody just moved in, we need somebody, get them. I need to see it. And I believe that the people, especially in this building, are, they're not crying wolf. They have children with really strong needs, and yet I don't hear about it as much as I do in another building, which has probably not even the same diverse community that we have here. In addition, I'd like to point out that the teachers in this building, unlike any other, unlike some other buildings that I'm working with, they join in and work for the greater good. They all work together. You'll see teachers doing duties where you won't see them in any other union school. Everyone pulls together in this building, and the students are not identified by your special ed and your ELL and your regular ed, and they're all kind of put together and they're treated as a community, and there's a lot of equity here. But also too, the teachers step up to the plate with and work alongside the IAs. So when I look at numbers that tell me that we're not substantially below, but we are below the state average, the state, we're paying $13,600 and the state average is $14,990. So $15,000 is the state average, we're paying $13,600. We also are paying below per student than any other school in the union. Not that that matters, but so it's hard for me when I hear, you know, I'm trying to balance what I'm hearing, and with a new set of eyes, I'm looking at it, you know, from the top and from the sides. And I have to tell you, last year and this year are two different years. And that, you know, bothered me. And I also have a sense that at some point, the Sunderland town fathers had said, use your reserves. Don't keep coming to us for money. Use your reserves. And we have used them. And we've made good use of them.
I think the question we were getting last night is more in preparation mm-hmm. for questions that are going to come from people in the community, which sure. is true. I mean, mm-hmm. if those questions will be asked. I mean, or points will just be made as if, it was evidence that we're, you know, being irresponsible in how we're spending money, even though that's, so I think to proactively explain why that's the case is definitely to our benefit.
But. Massachusetts, this is Desi, this isn't me, this is Desi telling us that we are below the state average in what we pay. And yet we have such a great product.
Dave, a question.
I got a few questions. Just looking, going back to a point earlier, I know she moved some items that were grant funded previously. I'm curious to know what is left in the budget that is grant funded, because as a general rule, both in overall budget practices, it's a little risky to fund permanent positions with grants. Mm-hmm. So I think you really have to label anything that's grant funded as at risk potentially for delinquent. And especially if any of those grants are up for renewal, it would be, a good idea to have that targeted renewal date so that you can see the potential timeline and when those affect the budget, because that could also kind of hammer us in a certain spot.
If you look at page 7, it says increase in central office percentages. Our early childhood coordinator, who's fantastic, she's world class, and what she's doing with our early elementary kids is amazing, and this will show in years to come. All the research says the more resources you put down in that grade level, the pre-K and the K, it'll pay off in years to come. She was completely paid by grant funds. My first month on the job, I think it was my first week, in my office, I had Patty, I had Karen, I had Kim. They just notified the grant's over. They just cut it off with no previous warning or anything. Her money was completely cut. And we had to literally move her on to our central office cost because a piece of her is in four schools. Then we got word our Title I was coming down. So our elementary curriculum director, we needed to take her off the grant and put her on. These are two costs that are driving the 2.47% increase in the central office. So we have a SPED grant, and the special education grant comes in, and it comes in for the union schools. This year, we've actually given a little tiny bit more to Sunderland than the other, because the needs are so great here. We're allotted a certain amount, we might have went over. The salaries, David's you're very correct. We are taking these salaries off, and that's part of what you're seeing this year. Removing music and Spanish, there's 23,000, that's 1%. And then our early childhood coordinator and our elementary curriculum director, that's 2.47%. That's what's really driving us, is the lack of funding. And now, when we look at the new budget that's being proposed by the federal government, they're talking about taking away our Title IIA funding, and on it goes. The plan is to cut $9.6 billion from education, but then to give $266 million to charter schools and 100 and something to choice schools. So that's the problem. We are losing our grant funding.
And Dave, if you notice on page 25 of 28, FY proposed, we're going to be receiving $15,806 from Title I, and for the SPED grant, 94142, $63,612. So that's a number you might be referring to, that if both of those were to disappear, that's another 80,000 or so. Yeah.
That's the potential depending on how stuff goes.
Right.
I mean, that's always, I understand the budget struggles and, trying to pay for stuff, but anytime you put a permanent cost on a non-permanent revenue source,
except usually these things come around. There's for sure, you're right. But these things often come around because you get mandates, and then they cushion the mandate with a grant that lasts for a little while and then goes away.
Right, it's a temporary thing. They've done it with police and all sorts of other things.
Yeah.
And just to follow up on your point, I think that we can struggle through this year because we had a temporary freakish spike in free cash. But I think like you pointed out, next year we're at a really, and this is a difficult topic for me because of the way I feel personally, as Doug probably knows it, but then I have to look at the budget side of it. And putting aside how we all feel about it, we have to look at the stark reality of the numbers. And whether we were required to bring up a budget by a certain percentage last year, the bottom line is it does hit and it costs X amount more. And then looking at the way we're looking at it now, we're looking at basically just the elementary budget alone next year would cause an override. That says nothing about, that would mean that if you just level funded it going into next year, we would need an override to not cut something. And that doesn't take into account any other cost at all in the town. Or even Frontier, and that's a whole other, we don't know what's going to happen with that budget going forward. So that's one of the things that people were talking about last night, is that that's just a simple numeric reality that we're going to have to grapple with. And as Doug said, I pointed out too, that the only override that's ever been passed since I've been here was a few years back, and that's only because after, and now I'm getting a little into the political side of it, because that's part of it, but that's only because in the end, after the override went in, we also had that same year the debt dropping off the tax rate for this facility, so that afterwards, and also that the override that
the net
was a targeted specific thing for capital costs. So people were, I think, a little more apt to pay for that because it was a very fixed thing that people have to actually look at and vote on. And after you add all that in, the rate was still lower. So it makes this a lot more challenging. So these are just the kinds of things that we're trying to grapple with and prepare ourselves for. So that's kind of what was a lot of what was going tonight.
And I think a lot of us that have been here when the overrides have failed, I don't think we're feeling optimistic about bringing another one. So I think it is a good time to talk about what are we going to do?
Yeah, I don't know where it would, what would happen this time. I do think there is that point about when it's some level, who knows, you know, if it's targeted, it might make a difference with an override. If it's targeted in the information about why, it's good, that might make a difference. But at the same time, we'd have to be prepared for if it failed.
One of my worries is it's almost like a quid pro quo kind of thing, that if we are going to ask for an override, we have to do some serious belt tightening here, because I don't think we can just ask for all the needs that we have and then just say, give it to us. We have to show that we've made this cut.
That's
we've,
some give and take.
Yes, we've made these hard decisions before we go and ask for it, and that's, I'm just thinking forward, there are going to be some difficult decisions that we have to make.
I don't understand what percentage we need to get to so that it wouldn't require an override. The 141, I thought, was a number that was for the whole school, both schools, the Frontier and...
That's a whole town.
That's the whole town. So...
That's the dollar increase in the taxable base.
And you've got that, and then any potential revenue.
Right, so, I'm hoping there's some.
And this is the problem with 2.5 is people have got it in their heads mentally that nothing can ever go up over 2.5%, and which is why overrides are difficult. And that's not really why it was put in there, but it's sort of become that it's become this mental barrier that, well, we can't go over that. Because, I mean, if you pick any category, you're going to find something that has gone up somewhere over 2.5%. But it just makes it
well, and if the
much more
the other strong financial support that we're getting for the school to run the schools is going away, then you know that money has to come from somewhere. So the 2.5 and it doesn't allow for that. So
and we have a negotiated 2.5 increase, 2.5 increase in wages.
Now,
for all our union people?
Do you happen to know, I was trying to remember what the following year's increase was.
2.5. So last year was 1, this is 2.5, next year's 2.5. So it's 6% over 3 years.
Okay.
And then we negotiate again. The degree changes, the not only the vertical steps, but the horizontal steps.
Greg, do you?
I mean, you're talking about the elephant in the room. The real elephant in the room is, do you have to do back-to-back overrides, which we know is a non-starter. Right?
Yeah.
That can't happen.
Well, and it sounds like the situation might not be like that, but I do think we should look at, you know, we're not going to do all of next year's budget now, but we should be. I mean, we know like 100K in choice is going to have to shift next year.
Right. There are
and so, you know, off the bat.
That's the thing is, do you try to dodge the bullet this year, lay the groundwork next year, and while I get about the belt tightening thing, also part of the what you prepare as to make people aware of is, tightening the belt sometimes causes cost to spike or revenues to fall off in other places. It doesn't necessarily.
Right. Well, and on that note, I would like to show, and I was talking with Patty about this earlier today, pull together, you know, what it cost us when we made cuts before in terms of choice and charter numbers. So the real cost to the town is not just our budget, it's also what the town pays out for choice and charter students. And if you look at that over the years, I think it all of a sudden our the total cost to the town isn't, you know, looking like, oh, all of a sudden it's spiking up, because we actually have no kids going out. We're paying zero to charter this year. I believe that's correct.
Yeah. $40,000 total in choice.
And $40,000 in choice out versus what
that's
we're bringing
eight.
In that 343 coming in.
What's the percentage choice of? Because I'm curious, have you noticed if there's a, so, I have to imagine that there's always a certain baseline choice of percentage.
I don't know the percentage-wise, but I mean, I think our numbers are comparable to a number of years leading up to the financial bottom dropping out in 2008 and 2009. And in those years, the choice numbers were still, there were still like single digit, you know, mid, upper single digits. So this 8, I think is, there's always going to be people who choice for various reasons.
That's what I mean. There's probably always a certain amount of noise in there that no matter what you do is always going to be there. So you have to look at like what fluctuation above that.
But when we have 8 going out and 46 and probably more that would want to come in if we had openings, then we know we're doing something right. So,
that's...
So I'd really, you know, I'd like to put together that picture too as we go forward in terms of like, really, yeah, we've spent more, but that's to also to save more. And not to mention provide the education we want to provide to the kids in the town.
And we also pointed out that we educate students here that if we had to send them out of district, special ed students with multiple disabilities, if we sent them out of district, it could go to $100,000 a pop, literally, particularly for your profoundly autistic students. And I'm telling you that our program supports those, both our programs, our early childhood program and our Horizons program, are supporting roughly 11 students that could conceivably cost the district a lot of money, but we're able to do it in-house because we have the capacity. We have the extra pairs here, and we have the extra pairs in the, you know, the pre-K. We're doing it, and it's very hard to quantify. This is something going on another time, to quantify a child and their needs with potholes and fire trucks, and it's very hard to quantify that, but the reality is we are saving money. But it's very hard to explain. And we talked about that last night. We talked about, you know, the Horizons, you were all there, and how it's helping, and how we have, you know, 6 profoundly disabled children in pre-K, 11 with multiple disabilities in pre-K alone. We have 5 or 6 students in Horizons. So I hear everything, and I hear all sides, and I'm here to do what you want done, because that's my job. I just, you need to help us figure out what we need to do, and where are our values, and what do we want, what do we value here, and what is it that we want to do to please, to have the best chance to put this forward.
Do your homework, you know, let them prepare. I think that's the, just look at the numbers, you know. Mm-hmm. You gotta be able to justify and fight for it in that sense, you know. But look, like I said, this year, you know, we can get through, but we already know looking ahead. And like I was trying to get across too about, like, when we're talking about the Frontier budget, that's only operating costs. I haven't even talked about capital costs. And, you know, we can say, oh, we're going to, you know, put a bond bill out for something, but the bottom line is we still have to figure out how to pay for it all. You know, that's the tricky thing.
Exactly. And I can certainly look at this again. I am tough when I have to be. I don't like to be tough, but... I can look, but I'm telling you, I can't see us getting down to what they're looking for anyway.
Yeah. I think even if we're personally, I'm inclined to go forward with the budget we have. I think to have, to be able to explain, if it doesn't get, you know, if we can't fund this budget for any reason, you know, this is what would, you know, likely get cut. So people have a sense of, like, what it is, you know, in particular that, you know, is at stake, you know, when we're talking about this. And so
the risk is when you run into override territory, because based on past patterns, you'll get it through the town meeting, but then
sure.
The bulk of the people who will oppose it don't go to town meeting. And that's where, and I'm just trying to like project out, like, you know, and then based on like the current political climate and the changes that could be rolling down from the federal level. Luckily, there's very little funding at the federal level really that comes down, so it's mostly on the state level, but it's still, it's gonna be, and I don't know what kind of changes they're gonna try to push down in terms of choice and things like that, but I've already been reading a number of things, you know, so.
Yeah.
I think that was a good point last night, to start marketing, really, and start talking
it's like
to the community
else.
Now
yeah.
About next year. Yeah.
We can market, but I do not know at this point how many school choice seats we have. So. People are here because they want to be here.
Right, I meant more market to our voters.
Mm-hmm. That's something you can do.
Explain. Yeah.
But
yeah.
You guys could, we could really get a campaign going that would explain everything that we've just talked about. We're not even paying the state average.
Well, that's the thing, too, is, I mean, and it got mentioned in the meeting, leverage the PTO in addition to bake sales. You know, how can we get people, because we each have only so many associates we know in the community. If we can get a wider reach.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a question about that state average number. That when you look at that, I'm curious to know, in other words, you're looking at a given town that's about X amount. I'd be curious to see for every town what their average, you have to pick, like what's their per capita income. Compare it, because I think that probably has some kind of effect on it as well. I understand we're talking about that number, but I'm a little hesitant to just look at that number in isolation.
Yeah, this is our per pupil expenditure summary, and it includes in district, and then there's a total for out of district, and total full-time, and it just, it's administration, instructional leadership, teachers, professional development, instructional materials, guidance, pupil services, operations, insurance, and it just takes the money we're spending. And the
right.
State average is all of the districts in the state, what they're spending.
Right, but what I'm saying is, as you pick any town, you have to also look at their ability to pay in terms of their wealth and everything as a town.
Oh, yes.
You know what I mean? So it's a little difficult to just say at face value, town A is spending X amount, you know, and town B is below it.
Right.
You know, town B might, while it's below town A might have a per capita income like five times the size of that.
Well, and again, Whately is spending almost $17,000 per student. Frontier is spending $17,000 per student. Conway is spending $17,000 per student, and I think Deerfield is at $14,800. So they're
and we're
what are we
worth
thirteen. I'm sorry, that's Deerfield. 13,600.
Can you send those?
Mm-hmm. I'm gonna send them to anyone. I have all my little notes on it too, but. Because I also put down the general fund, the grants, and what the total is. And so Sunderland is getting $833,000 this year for 16, $833,438 in grants.
Is this from DESE?
It is.
Yeah. Yeah, if you could send that to all of us, that would be great.
Yes, it was updated March 17th. I can certainly send this. It's just interesting data.
I mean, I'm sure I could probably find it too.
Just numbers. It's just like kids. We cannot equate numbers with kids. We can't potholes with kids.
Right.
Or,
but those are our peers. I mean, those are our peers in the union.
Yeah.
So, I mean, those are
and we're
particularly meaningful comparisons.
That's the tough part of it. Is people, people will say, well, we don't want to assign dollar signs to people's heads, but.
There I am with these per people.
In a way, you have to, because, I mean, as sad as it is, we still have to figure out. And it's just, we're just trying to figure out how to deal with the forecoming storm in that sense,
Well, I can tell you in Deerfield, we also had this tough talk. And we had said if we don't do something this year, it'll be $200,000 next year. And they worked really hard, and it was difficult convincing, the staff, the people, the constituents, and the stakeholders. We were able to cut $85,000 out of that budget, and that brought down our reliance on school choice. But next year, we're going to have to go right back and say. Okay, so we, it was like we decided to split the pain between 2 years.
Right, well, that's kind of what you have to do, right? So you don't have as much of a shock and fluctuation.
We will have school choice, but you could see that as we're spending it, we will only be left with 34,000.
Right.
And then we'll be relying on school choice for the next year. And depending on how many kindergarten students we get in, we may or may not replenish that.
Well, and there's no way. I mean, we spent whatever it was, or proposing to spend 425 and bring in 349, so we won't.
The kindergarten numbers right now, the 35, those are based on three different numbers. Folks who have already registered, folks we know who are in the process of registering, and also others who are on the town census that we haven't heard from yet. Yeah, so that number could go down a little bit,
mm-hmm.
Because the census isn't always accurate.
Or it could go up because people move in over this.
Or it could go up, yep.
Does this include the preschool we talked about last night too?
No, the preschool has 32 students.
Does the budget include it?
Yeah.
The budget,
yes.
Yeah.
Because the SPED revolving, and then you'll see there's an early childhood revolving as well.
Yeah.
So there is some funding, grant funding coming in, and that's probably part of your, well, it's only $20,000. and then our SPED funding and...
But this budget does include the...
It does include
the preschool.
And you can see there's 7 students that... are
it factors
multiply disabled little pumpkins that are going to need a lot of support, and hopefully we can fade that support out as they get into second and third grade.
That's one of the areas where we really want to try to work on that is
that's a good question,
and it's like a number of things in education, it's difficult to show a direct immediate causal effect, but there's loads of research out there that is, showing how much early childhood and especially preschool stuff, and especially when you compare it to high-performing other countries and what they do for their pre-K education. I mean, it's clearly got some very good benefits, but that's...
And we've seen that here at Sunderland. We've had students who have started off in specialized programs and are now fully 100% of the time mainstream regular ed class because of that early intervention and because of the intense services.
And not even just for like SPED, but for everybody.
For everyone.
I think it's a fantastic thing. And it's a need that we've had in town for a long time, going back, a number of years. And that's definitely the...
I've been talking about my household before the kids were in the school.
Right.
So.
and it's like kind of like what you were saying, but we need to reach out beyond
somebody had intimated about how we have to get more PTO involvement last night. I think there's probably, I mean, my kids have moved up to like Frontier now, but if it's anything like when we've been here, there's loads of involvement. I mean, I've spent many years flipping pancakes for the breakfast in there and everything. It's the people who are not directly, who don't have kids in the schools and things still, those are the folks that we really need to engage more so than just, because the people who are directly involved in the school tend to have a little more knowledge of what's going on and can see the effects more directly. So that's our, you know, there's a, mm-hmm. it's a different, for lack of a way to put it, it's a different market that has to be appealed to.
But I think our kind of arming people, with information, then that can go out into the broader community,
right.
Would definitely behoove us.
But you know, though, the conversations, the numbers,
right.
is one of the things you've heard about fake news. Well, we've been battling for years with fake and poor information out there.
Yeah.
I heard blah blah blah. Well, that's not true at all.
Yeah.
So there's always that.
Right, and prepare for. I mean, I think it is. We need to be prepared for. You know, the simple story is, well, the budget went up 10% last year and 6%.
Right.
What's going on with the school? It's out of control, right?
That's well, exactly. Yes. You can't take the number and face that because there's always an explanation.
Right.
That's what makes all this fun.
Maisie, you had a, you have a
Yeah, question. I had a question. I didn't know if you knew if the tuition from the pre-K ever showed up.
It comes in under the early childhood revolving, the EC revolving.
It's included in that.
And there is revenue. However, you can see we're hoping for 32 kids. We know 7 are special ed. So as a district, we're required to provide those services. So those 7 children, they don't pay tuition. The rest of the tuition is on a sliding scale. So depending on the demographic of the students that we accept, we really like to have typicals as well, a half and half mix, because the typical students are great role models and they're teachers.
Mm-hmm.
And they also learn empathy from working with other students. But what happens is, if it's on a sliding scale, there's the income isn't as much as we'd like, but there is, you know, there is income. And I believe it goes into the revolving account.
Is that, you think there's any chance for next year's budget that there's any kind of grant money out there that we might be able to?
There's grants that we're looking at. I know that our elementary curriculum coordinator is working with through the collaborative with many districts, because there's not enough of ELL English language learners in one particular school to get a large grant.
Mm-hmm.
But the collaborative is applying for a grant, and each school is bringing their data. So we are trying to get data for some English language learner services,
mm-hmm.
Tutoring after school, tutoring in the content areas. Which is very needed too with our demographic that comes up sometimes from Amherst. The families mm-hmm. are coming in and staying in Sunderland, you know, the southern part. I think that's South Sunderland. And so those are grants we're looking at. I just was notarized today for some early childhood grant. And I'm not sure exactly what that was for, but we are constantly looking for mm-hmm. grants that.
Yeah.
But the ones, the real solid ones that we relied on for years, the Title I and the kindergarten grant, mm-hmm. which, as Patty mentioned, the kindergarten grant is just gone away, because the now everyone has the full day. We have a early childhood grant or a preschool grant that we were receiving $36,000 for, and the word came down about a month ago that we will lose $6,000 next year, FY18, so we'll get $30,000, and I think we'll continue to receive $30,000, and then in 2020 it's gone away. That's the end of that. So there, at least that one we can prepare for. Mm-hmm. But that's, I think it's 20,000 across the four schools of the union. Mm. I don't think it's
okay.
just
not
for
all
us.
For us. Okay.
So, and again, things are just, the whole political funding, the state and federal funding, it's just right now it's kind of in a turmoil. And from the looks of it, it may not end up looking really great for education, public education. But the needs are still there. And these children are people.
All right. Well,
I can look again and...
Well,
I was just curious what our tuition looks like in comparison to sort of other preschools.
I can find that. I do not
I
have that. No, the person you would probably want to email, Rhonda.
Yeah.
She's really got her finger on it. And she could actually, if she doesn't have the information, she could get it really quickly. Kim would know.
Okay.
Kim McCarthy has been called, is becoming a part of task force on early childhood, and what that essentially means is that they like what we're doing so much here in our district with low funds that the state has asked her to come on to a task force, and she's over past Marlboro, they meet, and to share the ideas in the curriculum and what we're doing here that works so well, because our results are pretty amazing. And so they're essentially picking her brain.
I think Baker should fork up a $100,000 stipend for
that.
I'm just throwing it out there.
So she's been asked to be on a statewide task force for early childhood. She is fantastic, and what she's doing is fantastic. We can't really put a number on it, but again, it's hard for especially people that don't have young children to understand that connection between early childhood and the results, the higher percentage of high school graduates, the lower percentage of people who end up in jail, the data is all over the place on this. It's been replicated over and over again. But we are a model. Clearly, we're a model for our early childhood programs. And we're trying to, keep it going. And
so, public, our next phase in this will be going into actually our discuss and vote on it. So, but yeah.
Just one more thing.
Sure.
I won't speak to the other two selectmen, but I'm looking for a specific number.
Because I've heard that kind of bandied about. It's not. It's just pointing out the unfortunate issues that we're going to have to deal with. That's.
And it's hard for all of us here because we're certainly empathetic. We understand it, and we know you understand what we're up against. And I guess what we need to do is reach out to the voters and let them tell us and help have them guide us to what they want.
Well, and one of the things too that we had been getting going for a while too is having regular meetings with town admins and you and the previous administrators, because it's important to at least, you have to take care of the school, advocate for that, but you still also have to keep in mind the reality of the environment and what's going on so that you can kind of navigate through that. So I think those meetings really helped to figure out, and like I pointed out last night, that study on space and everything I think is going to be very important, because we had tried in the past to do some different, slightly innovative, different things with the way we structure the schools, and I think maybe we need to push it again, because you basically were always funneled into either a regional school or, into existing school models. And I hear all of this lip service about, how we want to be different and things like that and look for different solutions. Well, then take the handcuffs off us and let us be innovative. and try something different. And I think we may have some potential things that we can work with here. So, but we got to look at like our space, and it's also going to take the involvement of the other towns, because it's not something that we can solve on a town-by-town basis, because the problem is much bigger.
I can tell you, and I'm sure you heard last night, the other towns are feeling this, the pain too. So
it's not a unique situation. And like somebody had brought up last night, we get hammered more by choice in the rural areas, that being the Cape and up here, way more than the urban areas do. They have to deal with charters more than we do in a lot of ways. And we're actually lucky in that there's, if you look at the charters that are here, there's really, the other two, you can make an argument that they're serving a niche and a different need. But one of them clearly isn't. It's a direct competitor, so.
And I believe that our product is far superior.
And that's the thing, yeah.
I believe that's true. But
it's nice, yeah.
That's good advice.
Did you say there was 8 students that are choicing out this year?
Yeah.
Because I thought from watching the meetings last year, Patty said like that there was no kids choicing out. But then it sounded like you said it was sort of like...
No, there's never been.
I thought you said they all returned.
I think it's been single digits now for 2-3 years.
I know it's a year dead as
well. And this is the element.
Yeah, because I just remember last year, because she kept saying, oh, they've all returned, there's nobody. She kept saying that word, like they've all returned, there was nobody choicing out.
I think a lot of, and I would doubt it was zero also, but I think that a number of kids too who choice out of Sunderland did come to Frontier.
Right.
So.
The number was 8 last year.
Okay.
I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. And like I said, looking back over a lot of years, because back in 2009, you know, I was looking back there like 10 years, and there was, I think the lowest number I saw was maybe 6 or something in a given year. Because there's, again, no matter how great the school, there's different considerations that people have, so.
That's just what stuck in my head, because I kept thinking like, this is really great, there's nobody leaving, but then...
Yeah, I think relatively speaking, in a sense, like having a number that's like that in that 8 ballpark is like effectively not having people leave because there was a negative change in the school, if that makes sense.
And from my understanding, of those 8 students, none had started here and then gone elsewhere.
That's important. So, right. Exactly. So, that's one of those situations. They move town and they want to keep their kid in the same school. Now they have to choice into that school.
That's why I was trying to get at that number. It sounds kind of like it's probably going to be somewhere between 6 and 9. That
yeah.
No matter how you can have the most outstanding school, it sometimes the reasons that it's like we were talking about last night, the work location of the parents that have nothing to do with the quality of the school. So you always have to kind of factor that in as your baseline and then take that out of it.
Child care or whatever.
Right, there's all sorts of personal and other reasons.
In January, it says 6, 1 going to Amherst, 2 to Deerfield, 3 to Gil Montague for Sunderland Elementary.
Then this year?
January 17th.
The last list I saw I saw it yesterday, it was 8. Mm-hmm.
3 to Gil Montague, that's interesting. I mean, again, though, like you said, people, they probably started there and wanted to continue there. Because we get a lot coming in from Gil Montague. But did you, other?
Yeah, my other question, because I heard you talking about the preschool. My child will be out of preschool next year, but she is attending a preschool in another public school. Mm-hmm. And since we're out of district, we can't like get any of the sliding fee, you know, stuff. But they also charge an extra $500 for people living out of the district, which is huge if you can't get the sliding fee. But also they're tacking on the extra $500. But you know, their program is self-supporting, so I mean, it's like she's going there for a lot less time than what I could get here. But, you know, it's like, I'm just saying for you guys to maybe bring in some extra income. I mean, it's hard to tell a family that it's hard for them to pay for it as it is, and then you tack on an extra $500. But even if it was a little bit, I mean, I don't know how many extra would be coming actually from out of district. But
my understanding, and I could be wrong, but I believe I'm right, we don't take school choice in preschool. We really, especially in our Deerfield program and our Sunderland program, we will be full next year with the full 5 days full time. And in Deerfield, I think there's a waiting list.
I think we did used to take school choice though, and it was like you just had to pay the full tuition, because I had a kid that was choiced into this district. Then I had another kid that was preschool ready, and they said because we were living out of district that we had to pay the full price or whatever. And then I just decided, because I was expecting another child, that I just didn't want to send, like, I just didn't send him that year anyway. I just decided not to. But they did, but I think it was like they had a limited, that was in Waitley, so I think it was like they had, maybe their program wasn't full or whatever, but.
Yeah, maybe in Waitley. Yeah, you might, I could be wrong. But my understanding is we are full next year with Sunderland. We have enough applications for Sunderland for our program for next year.
And I know there's been some times where a school choice sibling in the upper grades was here at Sunderland, and then that the younger sibling came to the preschool.
Yeah, that was like the situation I was in. But they weren't saying they were going to tack on an extra fee because I was out of district. It was just that you couldn't apply for any of the sliding fee scale or whatever. It was like just full.
Mm-hmm. Full tuition.
Only for their own town at the time. Yeah. We're growing. The school is growing. We're cutting a wall in between two rooms to make room for the preschoolers. We're doing it cheap as chips, as possibly cheap as we can do it, and no new bathrooms. Because we had grand plans, windows and bathrooms, and well, let's cut a hole in this wall, and the kids can go and then use the bathrooms, so that we have two bathrooms in one room and none in the other. So Ben and the team, we sat down and we came up with a plan where it wouldn't cost us hardly anything to get the extra space needed to open up the program for 32 children full time.
And to piggyback on that, the current art and music room is going to end up being the 4-year-old preschool classroom. Big doorway space is going to connect the current art and music room with the current preschool room, so that kids by regulation have access a straight shot to the bathroom. And then we're mixing and matching in other parts of the building to move music and art.
We're running out of space?
Yep.
We've had to do it. Was a domino effect, so you know, maybe 3 or 4 rooms have to change.
Do a loft in here?
You could.
We are thinking out of the box, and we are trying to do things on the cheap. Like I said last night, we converted a locker room for OT and PT services, and that we did just put it right in the maintenance budget. We are trying to meet the needs of our kids without spending, certainly no capital, you know, anything like that. So we're growing. It's like a family that grows, and we can make a new bedroom. Have bunk beds.
All right. Any more before we go to the regular meeting? All right. Thank you very much. So that, I don't know if we have to, I forget if we have to vote to adjourn the public hearing or not and enter. I don't remember how that works. In past years, because we've been like, we used to be in the cafeteria, so like we kind of officially adjourned that, but I don't know that this now, I think it's just part of the agenda, so we'll just move on to the agenda, which would be to review the minutes and approve the minutes, or vote on the minutes.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes.
A second.
All right, all in favor? Unanimous, one abstaining, or 401, 401.
One abstaining.
One abstaining.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. I can talk a little bit about the financial statement and the warrants. Took them already away from you. But anyway, there are six warrants for your signature totaling $37,115.94. On page 5 of the financial report, we are showing a shortfall in special education transportation. There's been changes. It's the second line from the top of the page. There have been some additions through the...
Page 4, you see?
Page 5.
Five.
You'll see a shortfall of $3,131.63 through February. So at this time, she has identified two line items to cover the shortfall. On page 6, out of salaries and retirements, there is $5,869 in the account, and we don't apparently aren't going to be using that, so she's going to use that. Shift that $5,869 over to special education transportation, and then also to insurance contract adjustments, the expense for insurance contract adjustments. And that is $17,581.81. And that hasn't been used. And so what she's proposing and asking is that she move those two totals over to special ed transportation.
Because that's going to be needed.
It will be. We either took in a new student or we changed, I don't know, the profile. But Patty's statement was her projected shortfall through the end of the year is approximately $9,800.
$9,800?
Going the way we are now with the students that we're transporting through special education.
Oh, this is the middle, sorry.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's $9,800.
Okay.
So it's hard because IEPs change, students, they need to have upgraded services, they're not successful on the regular bus, they need to be in a special ed bus. Sometimes we need paraprofessionals or IAs to be with them on the bus. And so this one just came up quickly over the year.
So it wouldn't necessarily move all of that, it's just that enough to cover the 98,
yes.
Roughly. Okay.
Yeah, she'd like to cover that to the end of the year so that it won't be outstanding. Just switching the lines.
Okay.
So that's Patty's report. And?
Okay, thank you. Questions?
Not that I can help you. I rob Peter to pay Paul all the time, so. No, I can see where these lines, it's a good choice to use these lines. We're not using the, the contract adjustment and certainly the separation costs from retirement, we're not using that. So.
That's another issue too that we haven't tackled yet, which is future retirements, like being able to have that, in a way, I mean, really, that's one where, like, where the choice, like, it can be nice to have that choice money where in the year where you get hit with, higher than average retirement, that you can cover it out of that. But anyway,
it's
not for this year.
Do you
question?
Have projections? Because that's the number that has, like, wildly up and down.
I know.
Depending on
in a small school like this, it's going to do that.
No, I'm not sure about this school. I know Frontier has quite a large
I think as best you can large. Project that, it'll help you grapple with potential costs, looking at the potential age and on paper at least there's who maybe would retire next year or the year after.
Exactly. I'm not positive about Sunderland per se. I think Deerfield's 4 million, but I don't know. I'll ask Patty to get that information, the projected retirement. If we really want to talk about it now, we could wait until June after this is history, but we could certainly
I
think it's beneficial. I think a lot of people I'm working with are looking at it 2 or 3 years out, so it shouldn't really, in most cases, I don't think it should come as a surprise.
Right. I don't know about, particularly in this school, I'm not sensing that there's anyone imminently retiring in the next 2 or 3 years.
I can ask.
We're still in the family stage. But Ben could ask, and we could talk about that for the next 2 or 3 years. Thank you.
All right, then. We had the public hearing. We have public comment in this meeting. If there's any comment outside of the budget, I mean, my preference, honestly, in this meeting is to stay mostly on track with the budget. If there's anything that's, good. All right. So then moving on to the discussion and vote on the proposed FY18 budget. So we've talked a lot about it. we can have some more open discussion. We could have a motion and then discuss.
We've had a lot of discussion on it. I'm happy that Patty was able to find that savings tonight. I'm a little bit more comfortable with the number tonight than last night. So I'm comfortable with moving on.
Any other considerations or things folks want to talk about before going to a vote?
Make a motion to approve the proposed budget for FY18.
I'll second.
All right. So any further discussion before we go, huh? All right, that's good. All in favor? All right. Unanimous. Thanks. Thank you. And we'll see where it goes from here. I'll be doing my best to attend the rest of the season of budget meetings for the select board, and then heading in towards town meeting and so. Yeah. Okay.
Well, Monday night is. We've been invited back Monday night.
Yeah.
I'm excited about that. So.
All right, so then reports, any committee meetings lately? Any reports? Go to Principal Barshevsky.
Great. In honor of Dr. Seuss's birthday, we just recently held a Read Across American Day celebration. This occurred on Thursday, March 2nd, and once again, we invited student-athletes from Amherst College to come in and read to our students. As a follow-up to that, we've had a number of the student-athletes reach out back to the school to propose whether or not they can volunteer their time. So that's coming up as well, and we have a group of college students coming back to hang out and work with our students. Students in grades 3 through 6 recently enjoyed a presentation on solar energy. The presentation, which was put on by Kearsarge Energy, which was a key player in the solar field project here in Sunderland, included a PowerPoint presentation and then a tour of the solar array. Next year, they plan on coming back to do some hands-on projects with the students. And we're looking to expand the grade levels at which they meet with as well. I already touched on the transition to full day pre-K, where the art music room is going to be turned into a pre-K classroom. And if you flip it over, this is a brief outline of all the events that we have taken place at Sunderland coming up, including Band Fest on April 4th, and that's going to actually be at Frontier Regional High School. There's going to be a strings and sing concert at Frontier on April 5th. We have school committee meetings. We have a couple performances coming in, including the Eaglebrook String Orchestra and Jazz Group. We have the Academy of Charlemont coming in to do an a cappella performance. We have fun runs. We have, and on that actually, if you look on May 26th, we are planning a spring fun run. And next week, I'm meeting with the PTO and a few parents to look at ways we can raise money through that fun run so that raised funds can go towards a climbing wall here at Sunderland, a traversing wall, which would be located on the back of the stage. So that's exciting, and we hope to have that in place for the start of school next year. What else? Field trips. Our community service day is on June 1st, and I think since our last meeting, the date of sixth grade graduation may have changed. So now it's June 14th. I know I changed it on one of these documents, and I'm not sure if it was prior to this, the last meeting or not. Arts night on April 11th. Any questions? Yes.
Where is the new art music room going to be?
Good question. So the art room is going to be down on this end of the building where the occupational therapy and physical therapy room is going to be. The OT and PT are moving to the back extended classroom space that was being used this year by the preschool. This last summer, we created that space for the full-day preschool kids. Music is going to be moved to the at-a-school time room, and then we're changing the day of band so that it doesn't interfere with music and the space is not used by two different groups.
I'm sorry, the art, my brain was...
Art is going to be on this end of the building.
Okay.
Music is going to
stay down
on that end of the building.
Yeah.
Out of school time is staying as well. We're just gonna make it work. Yep, gonna share space.
Because art can be down here because you got a classroom.
It's not as noisy as music, and the it's in the center. The OTPT room right now. Uh-oh. There's classrooms on either side and across the hall. So we figured that would be a little bit more appropriate.
Are there any plans, I don't know if it's during the school year or not for summer, but are there any plans for Sunderland kids to take part in the town's 300th anniversary?
There has been very little talk about that. We had some outreach from a few folks in town, and that really hasn't gained any momentum. We'd love for the school to play some role in the ceremony. It's just
the only thing that clicked for me when you were talking about the fun run. I think the town's planning on doing a run throughout town in the same way. So I don't know if there could be involvement of the kids in that regard, or if there's something else the kids could do.
You mean for as part of the 300th celebration?
Yeah.
I haven't heard that, but
I can't. Off the top of my head, remember if it's during the summer or if it's during the school year. I have the feeling like it's not this coming summer. I think it's going to be the following, mm-hmm. either late spring or early summer.
Because the 300th anniversary would be fall
2018.
Mm-hmm. Right. And basically, if we, for the school to play a role, we would want to start planning next school year.
Yeah.
Because, you know, we show up to school in fall of 2018, the celebration is going to be a month later. You know, so tough to put something together. Mm-hmm. Do you have any suggestions what the school's involvement could be?
Have to run that through the ringer a little
bit. Okay, yeah.
Come back to you next time with a plan, maybe.
Sounds good. There was talk of putting on a play, but once again, kids would have to practice the school year before and then then kind of lose that from their mindset over the summer and then get going again. So.
I'll do some thinking and I'll talk to you at some point.
All right. Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Superintendent report?
I have none. I think that you probably heard more from me tonight than you have all year. Again, you know where my heart is, and we will do what we need to do, and we will continue doing what we need to do. With your guidance, we will hope for the best outcome for Sunderland School.
Thanks. And executive sessions tonight. So, take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
I got them down there. You want to second it?
Sure.
All right. All in favor?